to a leader of an organization that's undergoing transformation, I would ask them to take a look around and to say, who's not here and why are they not here? You know, who have we historically invested in and why, and like, where has that investment led us?
I'm Rich Frazier.
And I'm Russ Thanos.
Welcome to the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange, a podcast from IPM Advancement.
We believe strong nonprofits can change the world, and our goal with each episode is to bring you insightful conversations with thought leaders from the nonprofit sector.
Let's dive in. Hello, listeners, and welcome to NPFX, the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange. I'm your host, Rich Frazier. My co-host, Russ Faniff, is out today. Our topic for this episode is ensuring 21st century museums remain a relevant part of American cultural life and yet still operate with the greatest sense of equity. What does that mean? Well, we're going to find out from my guests today, Nico Wheadon, author of the book Museum Metamorphosis, Cultivating Change Through Cultural Citizenship, and Melissa Cowley Wolf, nonprofit consultant and contributor to Nico's book. Nico, Melissa, welcome to the program. Do you mind introducing yourselves and your backgrounds? Nico, let's start with you.
Thank you, Rich, so much for having me today. It's really fun to be back sharing a stage with Melissa, which was, you know, what we got to do as part of compiling the book a few years ago. So my name is Nico Wheadon. I'm based in New Haven, Connecticut, working mostly as a curator, arts consultant, professor of art, and, you know, now an author. I've always been an arts writer, but now kind of looking at the book as a platform that is intriguing to me. I got my start as an artist, which I don't think a lot of people know about me. So I arrive at all that work I just said as, you know, an artist first advocate in those spaces. And most of my career has been spent in culturally specific artist-founded spaces, specifically nonprofits, building programming and community engagement strategies within those spaces over the past almost 20 years. So that's what gets me up in the morning. I've lived a lot of places, which I think really informs my desire to think about and talk about community at all turns, right? As someone who feels very much like a member of quite a few kind of global communities.
Terrific. Well, welcome to the show, Nico. Melissa, welcome back. Not your first time on NPFX.
It's great to be back with you, Rich, and the IPM team, and to be here with Nico, who I'm honored invited me to contribute to her book, Museum Metamorphosis, which is really a groundbreaking text and look at the state of the museum sector, how it needs to change and how it could change, featuring a bunch of collaborators who are really that next generation of cultural leaders in the United States and beyond. So this is really exciting to have this conversation. I am the founder of a consulting firm called MCW Projects. I am the director of a media platform called the Arts Funders Forum and a member of the IPM Consulting Network. I come to this work after 15 years as a development professional within museums and visual arts nonprofits and institutions of higher education. And through that experience, I learned a lot about where the next generation of funders, audiences, and communities are going and how they want to be investors in, supporters of, and advocates for the arts. And so my consulting practice is based around working with cultural organizations to bring that data to them, to create narratives and stories that resonate with the next generation, and then create philanthropic plans and roadmaps in order to execute that and engage and recruit that next gen. The media platform is focused on creating new high impact models of support for the cultural sector outside of the traditional nonprofit model. And it's a very interesting moment now in this, you know, quote unquote, post-COVID growing social and racial justice and climate justice moment in the United States and abroad to look at these issues and make some very, very important changes in order to keep our sector relevant. So excited to be here and chatting with all of you and excited to dig in.
Terrific. And thank you, Melissa. Welcome back. Well, let's jump in here then. Nico, the book Museum Metamorphosis, Cultivating Change Through Cultural Citizenship, You mentioned a specific phrase, a crisis of relevance. So Can you break that down for us? What does that mean?
Sure. Well, this is going to be a little bit of a storytelling mode. I hope that's okay.
We love stories. Go right ahead.
Okay. Well, I think the easiest way for me to describe it, you know, for years, right? I think communities of color, low-income communities have been saying, you know, we don't see ourselves reflected in our public institutions. And I think we mean that in terms of, you know, the work of those organizations. We mean that in terms of the leadership of those organizations. And, you know, museums, I think, are really a part of that kind of group of organizations that we've been speaking to with that call. And I think, you know, there's a thing that's happened recently in the kind of, I guess it's still emergent, DEI movement and language that really kind of comes from a different place, right? The origin of that conversation is more rooted in like a corporate HR culture, just thinking and talking through kind of the lens of risk management. And so I think there's a real difference, you know, between like the communities that are asking institutions to have more equitable representation, you know, saying this is how we want to be represented. And then an institution on the other side saying, you know, this is how, when, if, you know, we're actually willing to do that and welcome you in. And so I think the tension between asking for representation, asking for access to institutional, you know, activity and decision-making power is one thing. And then I think, you know, it's really about how institutions are like basically saying we're really desperate to become more diverse, more equitable, more accessible, but they're not listening to the people who are not there about how to do that.
So it's a breakdown of communication, it sounds like.
It does, but it's also about value system and priorities, right? Because I think, you know, you have to trust what you're hearing. When you hear someone say, I don't see myself represented, you have to trust that that's real and that that's a real state of issue. And then, you know, position yourself as an agent of change in relation to that. And I think, you know, it's also a question of like function aligning with use, right? So I think a lot of people, a lot of communities don't actually need museums in the ways that they've been designed to be used historically. And I think that's okay. I don't think every museum has to be for everyone. That's never been part of my thesis. But I think if, you know, museums are held in the public trust, if they're supported through taxpayer dollars, if they have a nonprofit mission to serve, you know, specific demographics and communities, then, you know, they need to follow through on that responsibility, right? And so I think part of what that produces is essentially people going out and creating their own institutions and organizations that can actually respond to those needs, like with urgency and in real time. And so, yeah, it's part communication, but it's also part trust, right? That needs to be built, and that trust needs to be built over time and through a relationship.
I find this really interesting. When I'm in a city that has a museum of interest, I have time, I will go inside the museum, right? From what I know and what I've seen, museums are more than just a collection of art anymore, right? And for years, museums have filled this important role in uniting and bringing people together through exhibits and workshops and lectures and special exhibits that celebrate communities and cultures and creating unity on social and political and local levels. So I find this whole breakdown of understanding values systems and function versus use. It's not that I don't believe it. I just find I have a hard time understanding where it's coming from.
Yeah, I think what you're pointing to, Rich, and kind of referencing is that there's several different audiences and communities. And I actually think of those as two separate entities. I think the audience is those that are actually engaged with the program of the institution, that may have been members that attend events. Then there's the potential audience of those that have yet to be reached or yet to be included. The community is really the entire local, regional, or global community that museum can and could be touching. And also everyone is invited to these conversations. But I think where we're at now, and what we're looking at and what is being touched upon in this book, is that, you know, there have traditionally been excluded audiences, not necessarily intentionally, but just historically, there have been audiences that have felt excluded from the museum experience. And those communities traditionally line up with historically disadvantaged communities. That could be an issue of access due to pricing. That could be an issue of where that museum is in a city space. Is it inaccessible by anything but an automobile, which certain folks in this country cannot afford to have and rely on public transportation? Does the physical space itself, and Nico interviews and speaks with architects in the book about how the physical structures, the aesthetic structures of museums, promote the exclusion of various constituencies, that they are seen as institutions looking like institutions that have traditionally excluded various communities in our country historically over time. So I think for those of us that have grown up in and around the arts, that this is becomes a pattern of our life, that we frequent these institutions. But for those that haven't had the access, there has not been really the dedicated outreach or the understanding of really what that relationship needs to be. But most importantly, not the listening in the communities of how they can work together. And that listening has to be a dialogue. It has to be questions posed on the part of the institution, not telling folks what they should know, but listening to folks and then responding to it with the programming. And with regards to other communities, you know, we're living in an era of impact. People are really reevaluating what they value, who they trust, how they collaborate. And we know that the trust in nonprofits and institutions in general and governments is dwindling. And that's being reflected through the dollars and through the support of these institutions. So we have this set of cultural truths that we know are happening. You know, in addition, household giving is decreasing, student debt is ballooning. And all this is happening in the context of the largest intergenerational transfer of wealth in history. But we've somehow lost the narrative of how museums can make an impact on their communities. And I think that's what Nico was referring to, sort of the breakdown of function and use. Mm-hmm. And there's a real reckoning and question of what is the 21st century function and use of an institution that differs greatly from what we've known for the last 50 years.
You know, I think what 2020 revealed is that there was fire under people's feet to participate in a conversation around how their museum met issues of social justice. But obviously, those issues preceded, you know, the murder of George Floyd, right? And so I think we're seeing an increase in public discourse around these issues, but not because the issues are emergent, which is why for me, the crisis of relevancy is not, there's not a moment on a timeline. It's not part of a chronology. It's in the design of most museums, like at the ground level, right? And so I think that, to me, we're talking about a structural issue. And we're talking about how do you count people who are not present, right? I think there's something I heard once from a museum director who I will not name, you know, and she said that community engagement is a euphemism for everyone that's not there.
Right.
Right. And I think that's really telling, which is, you know, people sitting in a room trying to decide how to get certain communities involved in their mission and work without actually directly engaging and speaking to those communities about what their needs and interests are. And so it's how do you kind of transform a theoretical exercise into like the highest and best use of your institution into a real application of surveying, analyzing, understanding, and responding to needs that have been articulated and like will continue to be articulated, you know, on a number of forums. And so as someone who's an educator, a lot of my students bring a real fire and sense of urgency in addressing some of these questions around the capacity of institutions to shape and shift in real time to meet emergent needs. You know, I think there is this kind of burn it down mentality, which like I don't, you know, always agree with. Some days I do. but, you know, the truth is that like the change that needs to happen is so immense that there needs to be people on the inside of museums chipping away at, you know, some of the foundational elements that make them, you know, by design, places of inaccessibility and, you know, cultural exclusion and erasure. And then there also need to be people on the outside, not just artists, but like people that want to see themselves reflected in museum spaces, pulling museums into the future. And I think that the leaders of those organizations, you know, are the stewards and the hopefully the ones that are helping to guide along what is ultimately going to be like a really bumpy, you know, swirly path forward, which I think is great. Like, I'm all for the mess. And I think, you know, museums want a really polished strategic plan that will lead them to a place, a utopia where, you know, the mission aligns with the work, aligns with, you know, all these calls for social justice and everyone's happy. But the truth is it's complicated. And it's also complicated by the fact that most museums are embedded in this nonprofit industrial complex, right? So there is the question of how they are funded, who supports them over time, and what that does to the ability of the museum to transform.
From a user perspective, can you give me an example of what to look for in a museum that's going through a crisis of relevance?
Yeah. I mean, I would say if you go in a museum and it's empty and there's more staff on the floor, you know, protecting art objects than there are young people, you know, not even just young people, people of all generations and all abilities engaging that work in dialogue, I think to me that is like a pretty clear indication of a crisis. I think these spaces should not be uninhabited. The history should be living. It should be living through, you know, through dialogue, through artistic production, through education. And so I think, you know, one of the most frustrating things for me to witness, and this happened, you know, as we were writing the book, so we had to like go back and make edits, you know, was seeing the ways that like whatever happened with 2020 and everyone started, you know, holding on to their purse strings, and the first cuts that a lot of these big museums were making was to their education departments, and closed, their doors were closed, right? Because it's a pandemic. And so it's like, well, what are you if you're not these objects in conversation with contemporary issues, which are like never been more, you know, present, at least not during my lifetime. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it becomes a really interesting example of how museums show their priorities in these moments of tension and these moments of crisis, right? And so I think that to me would be like one indication. I think another, you know, is in the public statements that are made about, you know, there's plenty of examples of artists that have participated in, you know, different exhibition platforms within museums that have been mistreated.
Mistreated by?
By the institution. So not held with the same care that art by artists who are not of color, artists who are dead and their value has been kind of, you know, already claimed by the market.
Right.
You know, they haven't been respected as the producers of culture, right? And I think that to me is an indication of a crisis, because if a museum is able to detach the value of the art from the artist, mm-hmm. and from a really holistic discussion around who artists are as citizens that are making really powerful observations of not just what they see, but like how what they see fits into a larger picture of like the state of the world, then, you know, we're in a weird place. Like, I think that's like not a good place to be. And so, you know, I think there's like just so many endless examples. Those to me are the ones that stick out like really strong.
Hi, this is Curtis Schmidt, producer of the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange. If you're a nonprofit professional who has questions about your program, or maybe you feel like you've taken your advocacy, fundraising, or membership effort as far as you can and you need some fresh ideas, then we have a special offer for you today. NPFX podcast listeners can get a free 30-minute consultation with IPM Advancement, no strings attached, when you go to ipmadvancement.com/free. Just enter a few details and an IPM team member will contact you to follow up. It's that easy. That website again is ipmadvancement.com/free. Thanks for listening, and we hope to talk to you soon. Now let's return to the episode.
Is there a public perception issue for museums? Is there any sort of rebranding necessary to change public perception?
So rebranding to me implies that like the change is at a surface level, right? Or that it's like a shift in language or a shift in aesthetics or like visual identity of how we kind of talk about the role of art publicly. But, you know, I think what the book kind of advocates for, and I think the level at which, you know, I'm thinking about the change that needs to happen, like we're really talking about rebuilding the entire foundation of like the arts and culture ecosystem at large, right? And I think museums are a small part of that, but I think it's, you know, it's impossible at this stage to rebrand it, because I think when you think of like, you know, the solidarity, like the Black Square on Instagram, or the solidarity statements that came out in 2020 with the rise or the reemergence of the Black Lives Matter movement, you know, I think people called museums out for that. You know, they're like, thanks. But like, how are you actually, like, what actions can we see? What gestures exist for us to know and believe that you're walking in step with us as we are advocating for this change? And so I think it's really about like people putting their money where their mouth is in terms of, you know, action. And I think what you've seen more and more of is a lot of museums, you know, issuing strategic plans for how they're going to exist in right relationship with their communities. I think that's like new. You know, I think museums issuing value statements, museums auditing, rewriting their mission. You know, I think that all feels like activity that's taking place now in a way that feels less surface than the kind of change that we were seeing coming out of 2020. And so my hope is that, you know, people hold museums accountable to what they say they're going to do in these strategic plans, because I think a lot of work has gone into it. And in my role as consulting, you know, I kind of know what that work looks like, and I believe it to be possible. But it actually does take people asking questions in 5 years. To say like, well, where's the proof? Where's the evidence?
What Nico and I see, the organizations that are the most successful at this work of pivoting and really upgrading, you know, their DNA to resonate with where we are as a culture, where we need to go, and to really right the wrongs of the past, is to involve community in those conversations and to listen. Because these conversations that are happening within these institutions, being self-reflective, you know, it's not always easy to be radically self-reflective and radically honest. And sometimes you need someone in the room to call you out on it. And when these conversations are happening with executive directors and their boards and their top level staff, you're just not able to get the 360 feedback loop that you need. So, you know, the organizations that are the most successful are engaging their audiences and their constituencies in a series, not one, but a series of discussions or town halls or conversations about, you know, what is the perception? What are you seeing? What do you want from an institution like us? How could our capabilities and advantages as an institution in the community help serve your needs on the ground level, and what can that dialogue and interaction be?
It's really got to go beyond the strategic plan. You have to bake it into your DNA, and getting that feedback from community is so very important. Can you give us an example of somebody who's done that?
Yeah, well, so I think no one museum is going to be able to embody all the change that needs to happen, right? So I kind of, while I hesitate to pull one forward, I like continue to be really inspired by the work of my former colleagues at the Studio Museum in Harlem. And I think that what I appreciate about their approach is really looking to kind of cross-sector collaboration, unlikely partnerships. So thinking about grassroots organizations, you know, local schools, parks, libraries, folks with who you might share like a geographic or like a regional affinity, but the mission and kind of like nitty gritty of your work actually looks a lot different, but there's opportunity for alignment because you are, yeah, you're sharing a home, right? You're sharing space in a way that, you know, your ability to address the need together is stronger than your ability to address the need on your own. And so I think in general, museums that are small and, you know, as a result, kind of more nimble, I think you see them reinventing themselves in really exciting ways. I think it'll be harder for us to find case study examples of like really large, you know, kind of mainstream institutions doing the same. I don't think it's impossible, but I do think that they might have to have an inversion of some priorities to make that happen, right? Mm-hmm. And I think the last thing I would say is more and more that institutions are understanding not just the importance, but like the power of education, especially in our current economy where so much disinvestment has happened, right, in terms of arts education and public schools. I think there is this really rich opportunity for museums to be leaders in that space. And so I think, you know, museums that are able to reinvent themselves with a commitment to education at the core, I think that's like a really sustainable change that's actually exactly in line with, you know, the needs that have already been expressed.
Melissa, do you want to add on to that?
Yeah, I think, I mean, Nico put that so well. And I've been thinking a lot about this as I've been working with clients. And we're really in this age of almost decentering the collection as a didactic tool within institutions and centering the human and centering the community. And I think that by centering the human in the art sector in our institutions, I think could make us exceptionally relevant and poised to make significant societal change, and therefore to recruit, you know, a next generation of audiences, communities, and advocates. And this is something that's alluded to in Nico's book is, you know, the institution was a place of, collection, of conservation, of research, interpretation, and exhibition. And while that will still take place, and as Nico so eloquently pointed out, that the education department or education folks, the mandate of education, these institutions really touches and is exclusively dedicated to the person, right? To the dialogue. And I see that change happening across the field and the need for it to happen. And I'm heartened by those organizations like Studio Museum that Nico mentioned that are doing that. And that's a massive change in the history of museum scholarship and museum, the museum's role in our society.
So who's on board with this?
I think everyone knows it needs to happen. I think the world has caught up, the reckoning of society has caught up with the reckoning of the ecosystem. And we know we need to make the change. And for some leaders, for some professionals, that change is because funding is rapidly decreasing. From the short term, for example, relief funding, COVID relief funding is running out for institutions that have relied on that cash for the last couple of years. On the larger level, we're seeing next generation donors turn away from the arts to areas of social, racial, climate justice, education, and health. So for some folks, it's really just about the data that in order for the business model to continue, we need to change how we do business. Great. That's a good enough reason to change.
Right.
Hopefully within that is the recognition that our systems have promoted inequity for far too long. And what is our role with righting those wrongs? And how can we, as these institutions that do have collections and exhibit, tell stories and tell them differently and engage new audiences? So wherever institutions fall on that spectrum, they know they need to change. It's a matter of how, why, when, and who are their partners in that. And that's why, a book such as Museum Metamorphosis, I think, is exceedingly helpful for these institutions to really get a handle on these trends, to understand really why the change at a holistic level is so important, in addition to it just being good business practice.
Can we stay on the money for a second?
I'll always talk about the money, you know that.
We know that a lot of movements get moving when major funders make it a priority. So, and you mentioned sort of next gen philanthropists, but where do a lot of the big foundations and corporate funders of the arts sit on this issue?
In a lot of ways, these big foundations, I'm thinking specifically of the Mellon Foundation and the Ford Foundation, are leaders in shifting focus and really emphasizing that they want to fund institutions, individuals, and creatives who are doing this work of diversification, creating equity, doubling down on transparency, connecting the programs of our institutions with the fight for social justice that we are in, and centering the organizations that are doing that work from the grassroots levels up. So they've been huge role models. So then what happens is the organizations need to rethink, what are the stories we're telling? What is the work we're doing? How are we telling stories about that work? And how are we attracting people to partner with us to fund this work? So there's been a big revolution in that area, and it also mirrors what's happening with the individual donors, who are increasingly turning their attention to ways that they can create significant social impact through their giving. And they are, I'd say, really desperate for the link between how the arts do that and how the arts can drive change in the areas towards greater global progress. And it's incumbent on organizations to understand that and tell the stories and promote the work. That's an example of that. But the funding community, to a large extent, has been doing it. And we're not going to see that change anytime soon, especially as these issues become more and more pertinent and more mainstream.
For museum leaders who may be listening right now and are new to the conversation, how do they get started? What are the conversations they need to be having with their staff, with their artists, with their curators, with their communities inside their boardrooms?
This is like, as independent, where I plug the book.
Plug it.
Please.
As my own publicist, I'm like, buy the book, read it. No, but honestly, I mean, so I've had the joy of like writing this thing in community with 43 other people, right? And so there's so many perspectives that are present there. It's not just me. I don't position myself as an expert on museums at all. I think what I'm an expert on is bringing together diverse perspectives, in a really strategic way to offer solutions that have not emerged from the museum echo chamber to date, right? Because if they had, we would have answered some of these questions a long time ago. And so I think, you know, these 43 other brilliant folks that I'm able to, like, you know, just learn from every day have so much to offer some of these questions that we're asking. But, you know, if I were to actually speak directly to a leader of an organization that's, like, you know, considering undergoing transformation, I would, you know, I would ask them to take a look around and to say, you know, who's not here and why are they not here? You know, who have we historically invested in and why, and like, where has that investment led us? Right. Because I think there is a bit of audit and assessment that has to happen to really understand where you sit in relationship to the change. A thing I talk a lot about with museum leaders is like, yeah, looking at the mission of your organization on paper and doing, again, like audit assessment of how that shows up in your program, you know, and being honest about where some of those gaps are and how you fill those gaps, you know, who your partners are in filling those gaps. And then, like, you know, real talk, like, I think if it's 2022, you know, and you're just starting to answer these questions for yourself, you know, I think you honestly need to ask what took that long, right? Because I do think that either you've actually been doing that work and it's just been called something else, you know, or you haven't really understood it to be part of a DEI conversation, or, you know, you've just had some priorities that need to now be reconsidered or inverted, right? And I think all of those things are okay. I don't think there's no judgment in that. I think it's just We're in a moment of reconciliation and of self-reflection that, yeah, everyone needs to participate in this change, no matter how small it is. And the only way you get there is by, like, looking in the mirror and being honest about what you see.
And how do you enroll leadership, board members, staff, community in all of this? How do you bring people along?
I think it's being clear about the nature of the change you're hoping to affect and inviting people to see themselves as, like, integral to that change, right? Not as an outsider to it, that, like, it actually doesn't advance without them. And I think that's really, really hard work. That sounds easy. And it's like, you know, I'm sure that there's workshops leaders take, you know, to feel that that's what they're doing. But, you know, because I think, I forget who said this, but, you know, relationships move at the speed of trust. It's like, this is relationship building. And this is, you know, work that you're doing to build trust with stakeholders in the work that you're going to be collaborating with for a long time to make it sustainable. So, you know, putting in that time and effort to know who you're working with, I think, is a big part of it.
Who do you want to hear this message?
I don't know. I'm least interested in trying to drag someone kicking and screaming into this conversation, right? Like, I'm more interested in working with people that, you know, are really excited about cultural transformation, whatever that looks like for them.
Right. Melissa.
I would say everybody needs to hear this, because our museums exist in the public trust and everyone is a stakeholder in that, even if they have not felt included or have not been engaged. And that in order to maintain, you know, healthy cities, democracies, the opportunity to have conversation, the opportunity to engage with each other, to learn, to expand, to see different points of view, to argue, to debate. These institutions are necessary in civic life. And they're really, there's a really real existential threat that they will go away. And so I would say, let's cast a wide net. And then to Nico's point, you know, those that are most interested in doing the work, let's do it together. But I think we have lost sight as a society about how important these institutions are. And we've kind of been telling stories that appeal to certain segments of the population and have the sector painted as a, you know, rich, wealthy sector, when it's not. It's very, very scrappy. But that's the story we've been telling. And I think we need to shift that story. We need everyone on board to do it, to remind our communities that without these institutions, and again, they don't have to be in a bricks and mortar space. An institution can be, you know, a framework for dialogue and interaction and community development. So I would say everyone, and then who's ever the most interested, as Nico said, let's double down and do the work.
So what can other organizations learn from this conversation?
My hope would be that people can kind of identify different strategies, different tools, repurpose them for their work wherever they are. You know, it could be a theater, it could be, I'm actually working with a theater now that's going through a similar kind of moment of transformation as the Studio Museum when I was working there. And that's, like, been a really fun exercise in trying to understand the relevance of some of these ideas in relationship to cultural institutions more broadly, right? Because I think when it comes to accessibility, when it comes to questions of whose stories are told and how, you know, I think, Melissa, you talk about this so beautifully. It's like, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in that space. And I think that the book does offer tools for many types of folks asking those questions.
What would you like listeners to take away from this episode, Melissa and Nico?
A couple of things, but I think like what's floating to the top is just that one, like we're kind of in a state of crisis, it feels, and that's just perhaps like our new reality. And so if that's true, you know, then transformation is going to become this kind of like daily activity for all of us that we need to just become accustomed to. And I think understanding that it's hard work, it's difficult work, it's work best done in collaboration and partnership, really like encouraging people to go out and get the tools they need to participate in the change wherever they are. And so I think, yeah, just, you know, encouraging people to follow through on those instincts to be a part of whatever it is that is the kind of energy of this moment, and applying it, you know, to their own work, whatever that looks like.
Thank you. Melissa.
I think museums, as we know them, have been around since the dawn of time for multiple millennia. And it is a great moment to rethink how they work, especially as we are rethinking the systems and the structures in society at large. Every sector is undergoing this sort of need for radical honesty and self-reflection and listening. And so why would we be any different? And I would encourage folks to engage their audiences and their communities in this work. I'd encourage them to, and that includes their staff. I think frequently staff gets overlooked in these conversations, and especially in visual arts museums, as we discussed earlier, the staff includes arts educators who themselves are practicing artists, curators, teachers. These are folks who've studied their field and have a lot to offer and a lot of context to provide. And they're also largely the folks that are on the front line of the institution, speaking with audiences, communities, ticket buyers, et cetera. So to make sure you're engaging your internal team, as well as your external constituencies in these conversations, and to acknowledge as well that change is slow, change is hard, change is uncomfortable. We're going through change at every single level of society. So we all feel a little nuts right now, and that's okay. And to take some breaths and to know that if we are doing the work authentically, we're doing it in community, in dialogue, and in collaboration, that it's possible to make change that feels right for everybody.
Great conversation today. Thank you very much. Melissa Cowley Wolf, Nico Wheadon. Where can listeners find out more about you and the work that you're doing? Melissa, you first.
Sure. You can Google my company, MCW Projects. Also the media platform I run, which is a host of a lot of good research information on the state of the cultural sector, artsfundersforum.com, also LinkedIn and Instagram.
Nico.
Yeah, I'm realizing how autobiographical the book is. So I do think that if you buy the book, you actually learn a lot about my experience in museums and arts organizations over the past few decades. But, you know, if you want the Cliff's Notes, visit nicowheadon.com. A lot of my arts writing that is not in book form is available on my website. And then the Building Fund LLC, which is a consulting firm that I founded in 2020 alongside my husband, Malik Lewis, is where, you know, kind of my current projects sit.
Thank you so much, Nico and Melissa, for an important conversation today. The book is Museum Metamorphosis, Cultivating Change Through Cultural Citizenship. We appreciate you being on the program today. Thanks to Curtis Schmidt, our producer, and thank you always to our listeners. On behalf of Russ Faniff and myself, Rich Frazier, thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time on the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange.
That concludes this episode of the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange. Thanks to our panel for sharing their insights and expertise. If you'd like to learn more about our panel members or any of the organizations or resources featured in this episode, we will include links in the show notes. If you like this podcast, we would love your help spreading the word. First, please subscribe in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app so you always know when a new episode is released. Second, forward the episodes you like to friends and colleagues or share them on social media. Word of mouth is one of the best ways you can help us reach more nonprofit professionals like yourself. And if you use Apple Podcasts or Audible, please leave us a review. Positive reviews are how many listeners decide whether or not to try out a new podcast. We appreciate your help. For suggestions on topics, guests, or nonprofit organizations you'd like to hear on the podcast, send an email with the subject heading NPFX suggestion to contact@ipmadvancement.com. For back episodes and more resources like white papers, infographics, and blog articles, please visit the free IPM Advancement Nonprofit Resource Library at ipmadvancement.com/resources. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.